Hope you all are good, fine and healthy. So today, from today onwards, we are going to start our fourth semester classes. First of all, coming to the fourth semester, our paper name is Statistical Inference. So in third sem, we have studied about the statistical methods. What are the different methods that are available in the statistics? We have studied some methods like correlation, regression, and in the statistical methods itself, the third unit, in the fourth unit, we have started the little about the inference also. So we have discussed many times about the statistical inference. What is statistical inference or the inferential statistics? So basically, statistics is of two types, right? The first one is descriptive statistics and the second one is inferential statistics. So we have studied about the descriptive statistics in our first semester, right? So in the first semester we have studied about the descriptive statistics. So what is the descriptive statistics? Descriptive statistics means which describes our data. In the name itself we have that is descriptive, that means describes our data. So we have studied the several measures of the descriptive statistics like the measures of central tendency, measures of dispersion, movements, skewness, kurtosis, mathematical expectations. So all those describes our data. That means what is the variation in our data can be known by the dispersion. What is the central observation of our data can be known by central tendency. Movements refers to the positional averages and mathematical expectations are also the averages itself. Skewness describes about the curve of our distribution. That means is our curve stretched right or left. Like the kurtosis also describes the curve, that is the peakness or the flatness of the curve. So all those just describes our data, but we are not using any sample data or the for giving the conclusions about the population. Whereas inferential statistics, so what is an inference? Inference means conclusion, right? Basically, inference refers to the conclusions. So in the inferential statistics, we are going to provide the conclusions about the population parameters. So we know what is the population. Population means the group of individuals under the study are called as the population. So whatever the elements you have under the study, the complete elements together is known as the population. So in the population, we are going to have some constants. So the constants in this population are termed as the parameters. So inferential statistics means we are going to provide the conclusions about the population parameters. What are the parameters we have in the population? We are going to provide some conclusions about those parameters by using the sample data. So sample means a subset of the population is called as the sample. A small portion taken from the population is called as the sample. So by using the sample, suppose I want to know about the population. So whenever you have the large population, you cannot test all those large population values. So in that case, but I want to know about that population. I want the conclusions or some inferences about that population. So I cannot analyze the complete population data. So I'll select some sample based on some techniques. We are going to draw some sample. So by using the sample data, so in the sample, whatever the units you have, all those units to called as a random sample. So we are going to pick up a random sample. So on that random sample, based on that random sample, and we are going to apply some methods on that, and we will be getting some conclusions about those samples. So whatever the conclusions we get for the sample, that will be applicable for the population also, because we are going to select the sample in such a way that sample should represent our population. We are not going to just simply take out the sample data, or whatever the sample data is there, that should be representing our population data. It should resemble our population data. That is why what are the conclusions which we have drawn from the sample will be applicable for the population. So inferential statistics means it provides the conclusions about the population parameters by using the sample data. It provides the different methods for drawing the conclusions. Not only conclusions, or it may also provide the different methods in how to provide the inferences. I'm just saying that I will be getting conclusions, that is called as the inferential statistics. To get those conclusions, what are the different techniques we are going to use? That means the different statistical methods what we are going to use to get the inference, that is conclusions about the population parameters by using the sample data, together is termed as the inferential statistics. So this is about our paper title. Our paper title is statistical inference, that means which deals about the inferential statistics. So same like our previous set. So it is a continuation of the third set. If you remember all the methods, because in statistical inference we are going to use some methods for deriving the conclusions. We are going to perform different tests to get the conclusions. So you have to remember the basics of the third unit also, third semester also. In the third semester, unit 3 and unit 4, we have started the inferential statistics. So it is a continuation of that one. So in the inferential statistics, in the last set, we have studied about the method of estimation. That means we are just estimating the parameters, but here we are going to test our parameters. That means whether whatever the conclusions, whatever the assumptions we made, whether our assumptions are correct or not. First we make some assumptions about the parameters, that is the population parameters. Then we will check whether the assumptions whatever we made, those are true or not. So by using some tests or some methods, we are going to test our assumptions, that is called as the inferential statistics. So coming to the syllabus, so in semester 4 also, we are going to have total 4 units. So coming to the unit 1. So unit 1 is related to the test of significance. So unit 1, it is related to the test of significance. So in this first unit, we are going to study all the basic terms which involves the test of significance. So significance means we are testing, we should have more than one value. We will be checking both are significant or not, just in the casual way. But coming to the statistical significance, we will be testing the two different samples, whether those two samples are same or not. So we will be learning deep about it. So first coming to the just a brief of the introduction to the syllabus. First we will be studying about the test of significance and the statistical hypothesis. So hypothesis means it is a statement. So the statements given about the population parameter are called as a statistical hypothesis. I'll describe each and every definition clearly in the coming video. First, as the syllabus is, we'll be learning about the statistical hypothesis. different types of statistical hypotheses. We are going to have simple hypothesis, composite hypothesis, and to test the significance, first we have to describe the hypothesis. That means first we have to write some statements or assumptions about the population parameter. Then based on that statement only, we are going to select the method and we are going to draw the conclusions. So first thing is you have to know about the hypothesis and different types of hypothesis. Next is critical region and acceptance regions. Critical and acceptance region. So for any probability, I am saying we are drawing the conclusions. How we are drawing the conclusions? By assuming some statements. So I will be saying the statement is true and I will check whether it is accepted or not. I will give some statement and check whether it is accepted or not. So whatever the regions related to the acceptance and the rejections, on the based on the given statement only, we will be getting the acceptance region and the rejection region. So that rejection region is called as a critical region. Don't worry, we'll discuss all the definitions one by one. I'm just giving the overview of the syllabus. Next, we'll be studying about the types of tests. So this test may be of 1-day test and the 2-day test. So you'll be having 1-day test and the 2-day test also. Based on this test only, we are going to provide the inferences. So everything is interlinked. We will be studying about the test of significance, what is the hypothesis, the acceptance of the critical region, and the test, that is which type of test we are going to perform. Based on the hypothesis, we are going to decide which type of test it is, whether it is a 1-day test or a 2-day test. Next, we are going to study about the test functions. So, in test functions, we are going to have two types, that is randomized test and non-randomized test. Randomized test and non-randomized test. So, there are two types of test functions. That is randomized test and non-randomized test. Based on that two tests, you will be having different procedures of finding the conclusions. So in this first unit, the main important topic in the exam point of view also, that is NP's lemma. We are going to have a theorem which is called simply as NP lemma. NP lemma means Neman-Pearson factorization lemma. Neman-Pearson factorization lemma. So this theorem is used for the randomized test. So for randomized test, we are going to use the NP lemma, that is Neman-Pearson factorization lemma. So for the randomized test only, we will be using this NP lemma. So under this NP lemma, we are going to find the critical regions. So basically, this NP lemma is used to find out the critical region. Critical region means the rejection region. When under what conditions you are going to reject the hypothesis? We will be specifying some hypothesis, right? So when you will reject that? At what points we are rejecting? That is called as a critical region. So by using this NP lemma, we are going to find the most powerful critical region. So among the critical region, what is the most powerful critical region? We are going to find out by using the NP lemma. So under this NP lemma, we are going to find the most powerful critical region for the different distributions, that is binomial, exponential, Poisson and normal. So for this four distributions, we are going to find the most powerful critical region by using the NP lemma, that is Neman factorization lemma. So this is our unit 1. one and other will be interlinked. You need to carefully observe all the definitions. Now coming to the second unit. In the second unit, we are going to study about the large sample test. So large sample means whenever the sample is large, that is n value, we represent our sample size with n. So if n value is greater than or equal to 30, that is regarded as a large sample. So for this large samples, what are the different tests applicable? That we will be studying in the second unit. So we are going to study the large sample for means based on the proportions, based on the standard deviations. We are going to study the large sample test for singles and two means, single proportion, two proportions, and single standard deviation and the two standard deviations. Next, we are going to study about the Fisher's Z transformation. So this Fisher's Z transformation is used to study about the population correlation coefficient. Test of significance based on student feedback. So student feedback, we have studied the key statistic. Two types of key statistics will be there. That is student feedback and the teacher feedback. So two student feedback. The test statistics given as t equals to x bar minus mu by s by root n, which follows t distribution with n degrees of freedom. So based on this statistics, what are the different significance we are going to find? What are the different tests which comes under the student t test? We are going to find all, we are going to learn about all those tests which are used to test the significance based on the student t test. And also the next we are going to find the significance based on the F test also. So we know F test is used to find the ratio, right? Always we will be finding the ratios for the F test. So F test is used to find the equality of the variations or the variances. Equality of the population variances. So whenever you have two population variances, to test the equality of those two population variances, we use this F statistics or F test. Whether both the population variances are equal or not, to compare those variances of the population, we use the F statistic. So this is about the unit 2 and unit 3. Next, coming to unit 4. So I will be sending you the syllabus copy. So as soon as the classes starts, on that day I will be sending you the same day the syllabus copy. So first write down the complete syllabus on the first page itself. If you write down the syllabus, it will be easy for you to know what all, how much is left out. You can make an analysis of it. So first page, don't forget to write the syllabus. So in unit 4, we are going to study about the non-parametric tests. Non-parametric tests. So parameters means the values or the constants in the population. So if we are, I said in the test of significance, we are going to make some assumptions about the population parameters. So suppose if the probability function is unknown, or the way that we are not making assumptions about the parameter, that are called as the non-parametric test. We are not going to involve any parameters in this. So these are, that's why they are called as the non-parametric test. So what is the non-parametric test? How it is different from the parametric test? What are the similarities and dissimilarities? We are going to learn all those, and the different measurement scales. So we know about this measurement scales. We have used this also, but we exactly don't know that this is a measurement scale. So in the correlation, in the rank correlation, we'll be writing all the values in an order, right? Rank means the order. That means that is called as the ordinal scale. Suppose if we are writing the class interval from 10 to 20, 20 to 30, that is that we are writing the values in particular, you are measuring the values in a particular interval. So that is called as the measurement scale under the interval scale. So we know it, just we don't know which name comes under what. So we will be studying different measurements of scales. And next is we are going to study about the central limit theorem. So this central limit theorem we had in our first sem also. So the central limit theorem gives the distribution about the sample mean. So if x follows normal with mu comma sigma square, then x bar follows normal with mu comma sigma square by n. So this is the overview of the central limit theorem, that we are going to find the distribution of the for the drawing the conclusions about the population by using the sample data. So all this fourth units you will be studying about the different types of tests. On what basis you are going to give the conclusions? First you have to decide which type of data you have. For that data, what are the assumptions we are going to make, and based on the assumption, which test is applicable. So for that test, what are the conclusions we are going to give? So for different tests, we'll be having different conclusions. So each and every test you have to follow very well, because all the tests will be internal. If you understand any one test, even if you miss even a single class, you cannot understand it. That's why, unlike your third sem, don't miss any video lectures. Just follow all the lectures and write down the notes from this only. So I'm going to give the complete notes. So last time I've given you the PDFs. So this time I'll be writing all the notes almost related to problems, and the procedures will be there. So I'll be writing all the procedures and problems on the board itself. So you have to copy all from the board only. If anything it is theoretical, if anything any answers are theory, then I'll provide the notes for that.